So our first speaker is Roderick Overzier. How do you pronounce your last name?
Perfect. Overzier.
Overzier, okay. And he's going to talk about the Giant Magellan Telescope and the first cosmic sources. So I will let you know when you have 5 minutes left, okay?
Okay, thank you very
So you can
much.
start.
Thank you very much for the invitation. It's been great to see what everybody's been up to this week. The project that I'll be talking about would not have been possible without the vision and leadership of Juan Steiner. We've lost several great people in the last 2 years. Ruben Ofer, of course, Ronald Shattered last week, and Juan last year. And if he was still with us today, I'm sure he would have been very happy to give this presentation to you today. So the Giant Magellan Telescope is a project led by the Giant Magellan Telescope Organization, which is headquartered in Pasadena in the U.S. There are eight American partners and four international partners. Besides our Brazilian group, there is Korea, Australia, and the Weizmann Institute in Israel. And then, of course, there is the host country, Chile. FAPESPE is a 5% partner in the project. The PI is Laert Sodré, who is here as well. And the co-PIs are Claudio Mendes de Oliveira and Augusto Damanelli. I'm a member of the scientific advisory committee for GMTO. And we're doing our work in Brazil as part of the GMT Brazil office. Now, I'm sure you are aware that there are currently three of these super-duper telescopes planned that all should be ready somewhere around 2030. The GMT in Chile, by far the largest of the three, the ELT, led by ESO, with a mirror of almost 40 meters, also in Chile. And then the TMT, which is planned to be built in Hawaii. So the ELT is certainly the largest project here, but it also means it's the most complex one. The TMT is unfortunately in very difficult situation currently. Either way, having two or three giant telescopes by the 2030s will not be a luxury. If you think about the fact that today we have much more than 10, 8 to 10 meter class telescopes, and still it's not enough, right? And so even though ELT is the bigger telescope, you can only point it at the sky in one spot at one time. And so having several of these projects in development is very important. Now, the GMT project is real and has been underway for several years. This is the site some time ago at Las Campanas in Chile. You can see the foundation, the excavations of where the foundations of the telescope enclosure and the telescope pier will be built. The telescope sits on an extremely heavy pier, as we call this, which is seismically isolated from the telescope itself. And that's because Chile is an earthquake-heavy country. This entire structure is built on a set of bearings that allow the entire building to shift half a meter in each direction in order to completely isolate this incredibly expensive instrumentation in the case of earthquakes. And this is the site as it should look like eventually. It's not too far off from where currently there are the 2 7-meter Magellan telescopes. There'll be some support sites. Anyway. So the enclosure of the telescope is going to be an enormous building. It's 22 stories high. This is, I think, about as high as the SpaceX Starship rocket, Starship spaceship on top of the heavy rocket, super heavy rocket. protects the telescope against weather and earthquakes. The dome rotates in 3 minutes. And actually the dome has been designed to fully disappear when you're observing, right? You want to regulate temperature and airflow within the dome as if the dome wasn't there, in order to minimize any disturbances on your observations. Now the real beast of the construction is what's called the telescope mount. This is a construction that will be as high as the classic space shuttle. In 2019, GMTO awarded one of the largest contracts that is part of the GMT construction to build this this structure. It will take about 9 years to build. The structure will need to carry the mirrors, the instruments, the adaptive optic systems, and all the instruments. It's completely isolated against vibrations and earthquakes, as I mentioned, still allowing a frictionless motion in 3 degrees of freedom. The primary mirror consists of 7 segments, each 8.4 meters. So essentially what you have here is all 4 VLTs plus the 2 Gemini telescopes plus the Subaru telescope all working together. 2 mirrors have been finished. 4 mirrors are currently in various phases of production. It takes several years to go from a pile of glass to cooking the glass and then polishing it in the final final shape. The 6th mirror was recently cast in the oven, and the glass for the last mirror has been purchased, if I'm not mistaken. And together this forms a 25 meter parabolic shape. And one cool feature is, if you look at the figure on the bottom right of my screen, is that the, of course, above the primary mirror sits the entire structure that holds the secondary mirror, which is also an enormous structure. But this structure almost entirely disappears in between the spaces in between the mirror, primary mirror segments. And the secondary mirror hangs above the hole that is in the central mirror of the primary mirror. Okay, so we make almost full use of the effective area of the primary mirror of the telescope. Now the secondary mirror, of course, hangs dangerously above the primary mirror. It consists of 7 segments of 1.1 meter each. Earlier today, Renato talked about a survey done by Brazil and Spain using a 1 meter telescope. Well, this is 7 of such telescopes just hanging there, forming the secondary mirror. And these mirrors are special because they contain 700 actuators that vibrate at a rate of 2000 times per second in order to allow for adaptive optics to correct the image that is disturbed by the Earth atmosphere. And this then focuses the corrected light down to the instruments, which is shown in this little animation here. And you can see that it's a very compact telescope, which makes it very stable and steerable. It is also very fast. So there's a very direct path from the astronomical source reflecting on the primary mirror, going to the secondary mirror, and then straight to the instruments. Whereas a telescope like ELT, which is even more enormous than GMT, has at least 5 reflections until the final observation. Below the primary mirror, there's room for 10 scientific instruments, and there's currently 6 instruments in various stages of development. Now in Brazil, our participation is done through the GMT Brazil office, which currently involves members from IAG, Instituto Mauá de Tecnologia, USP Politécnico, Univap, UFABC, LNA, IMPI, and ON. And I will spare you all the details about these instruments and just tell you that we're involved in various aspects of at least 4 of the 6 scientific instruments. We're also involved in the control software of this adaptive secondary mirror. We have a seat on the scientific advisory council of the telescope, We have a seat on the board of directors, and we have unique outreach and education initiatives that we're developing in Brazil. For the next years, we plan new activities in various instruments, which ensure that we have an even greater participation across the project. And if you're interested in more details, I invite you to go to the website of GMT Brazil office. Now, the current investment made by FAPESP is $45 million. This is the largest FAPESP project to date in all sciences, if I'm not mistaken. So you might ask, well, what does that actually get you? Well, it gets you a founding partnership. So FAPESP is a founding member of the telescope, which means that this project would never have gotten off the ground without this these contributions from the founding members. And it also shows the value of having FAPESP or Brazil as a reliable international partner, which should benefit other projects as well. More concretely, the $45 million buys a 5% share of the science time when operational. And this could, of course, be increased if the share is increased. It also means that we participate in development of a major telescope of the next decade. So we are part of all discussions on operations, instrumentation, design, software, engineering, the science, looking for new partners and donors. It helps us to grow international competitive in astronomical instrumentation, engineering and software for major telescopes. We also think it helps us to develop our scientific community around some of this frontier science that GMT will enable. And I think you should also not overlook the fact that having such a project acts as called a great attractor or a catalyst to engage the general public in science. And so the return or amplification of the investment, of course, it's hard to express in dollars or reais, but I think it's considerable. So one aspect, an important aspect of these giant telescopes, all of them, is the adaptive optics. So all major telescopes today have enhanced their capabilities using the adaptive optics, the power of adaptive optics. And this is really what will make the difference between a telescope like this and, for example, a telescope in space like Hubble or James Webb that don't have adaptive optics. Of course, they also don't have an Earth atmosphere that bothers them, but their mirrors are relatively small compared to these giant telescopes. So if you compare what an ELT sees without an adaptive optic system turned on, shown here on the left, it is maybe of the quality a little bit below what the Hubble Space Telescope can currently do. But once you have the adaptive optic system turned on, you actually do better than what the James Webb Telescope will be able to do. Plus then the fact that you have a much larger mirror, okay? So you collect many more photons. This schematic explains how this works. Basically, you have an undisturbed wavefront coming in from your astronomical sources. This gets distorted by the Earth atmosphere. You collect this distorted wavefront with your telescope. You pick off a small fraction of the light to a wavefront detector that basically analyzes the distortion of this wavefront. And then it steers the deformable secondary mirror in order to correct for the distortions in the wavefront. And as long as you do this on a timescale that is at least as short as the timescale on which these disturbances in the atmosphere change, then you can refocus the light into the original point source very close to the diffraction limit of the telescope. So this is comparing the effective areas and the AO corrected PSFs that HST, JWST, GMT, and ELT will be able to achieve. And one thing that's interesting to point out here is that if you look at wavelengths roughly below 2 micrometers, then the ELTs, they win from James Webb, both in imaging and spectroscopy. Especially spectroscopy, the ELTs will be far superior. However, above 2 microns, the James Webb will always do unique science simply because the Earth atmosphere doesn't allow us to observe at wavelengths below 2 microns. So one scientific area where this helps a lot will be the science of the galactic center. Here you see an observation in the middle panel of what, I closed my own presentation. My apologies. Let's do this again. Okay, there we go. So here in the middle panel is showing you what's the current state of the art using the VLT with the laser target adaptive optic system on. And on the right is a simulation for the GMT in the J band. And so this should be significantly better for analyzing stellar motions close to the galactic black hole. It also helps beyond the galaxy. If you characterize the black hole sphere of influence, right, that's the G times the mass of the black hole divided by the velocity dispersion squared. Then this gain in angular resolution of about a factor of 10 gives you a direct gain of a factor of 10 in the limiting black hole mass that you can reach. And so this means that we can probe the motions of stars and gas around black holes around much smaller black holes in nearby galaxies. And we can even measure dynamical masses of black holes out to redshift 1 for very massive black holes. Now, an important aspect that I haven't mentioned yet is that both GMT and TMT are about half funded. These are $2 billion projects each. Current funding is about at a $1 billion level. And so there is a big plan that is called the US ELT program. And the plan foresees that the NOAR lab in the US, which used to be NOAO, becomes a 25% partner, both in GMT and TMT. Then NSF will provide the money to pay for this. And then the remainder will then be collected by finding new partners, donorships, etc. And one major, or perhaps the main hurdle, was the outcome of the ASTRO 2020 decadal survey that happened over the past 2 years. And so we have been working very hard to make this proposal of the US ELT program look as appealing as possible. The results were announced last month, and fortunately, we received the highest recommendation by the ASTRO 2020 committee for ground-based astronomy. So they say here that the ELTs will provide observational capabilities unmatched in space or on the ground, enable hundreds of new discoveries, a huge range of new discoveries. So this has now opened the door to pursue a large flux of money from the NSF. Now, the science cases of the GMT, I'm not going to go too deep into this because we're really talking about science that of 10 years from now, and that's really difficult. But it is important to say that the GMT instrumentation is all designed to address a wide range of specific key questions in all these areas. Just to highlight a few, looking for biomarkers in the atmospheres of exoplanets, the formation of planets and the birth of stars, The death of stars, projects like the LSST will find numerous transient objects, also gravitational wave observatories, that need to be followed up. A lot of these transients have to do with catastrophic events, explosions of stars, tidal disruption events. There are many aspects of cosmology and galaxy evolution that GMT will be able to contribute to, and of course in a very important area, first light and reionization. Now here's my disclaimer, is that none of the, if you look at science books that have been written, like the one for GMT, for other observatories in the past, where we can already compare the science book and what these observatories actually discovered. If we look at, for example, the Keck telescope or the Hubble Space Telescope, many of its of the main discoveries of these projects were not even mentioned in these science books. So it's a little bit predicting the future by looking at the sludge in your coffee. And also don't forget that the universe is going to be a very different place by 2030. This decade we'll see James Webb, hopefully will be launched in 1 or 2 weeks. The Subaru Prime Focus Spectrograph will perform an unprecedented extragalactic and cosmological survey, another project led by Laertes Sodré for Brazil, by the way. The Vera Rubin Observatory, we've heard Mariana's talk just before the break. And of course, the Square Kilometer Array, which should come online roughly maybe a few years before GMT. So I have a couple minutes left, and I cannot resist. I will just show a few slides of work that I'm interested in.
I was just going to say that you have 5 minutes, but
great. Go ahead. Thank you. So I'll just go over a few things that I find interesting that will probably find some way into being interesting or useful for GMT as well. One of these is galaxies in the epoch of reionization. So we all know that the epoch of reionization occurred as the first galaxies and quasars ionized bubbles of hydrogen gas around them. First, these bubbles are isolated, but then they soon all overlap and the whole intergalactic medium becomes ionized. We don't really understand how this happened. And that is not only a problem for cosmology, a problem due to cosmology, but it is a pure astrophysics problem. And that is because the centers of galaxies where these UV photons need to be produced, they are covered by very high column densities of neutral hydrogen. And so it's not clear how these UV photons can ever make it out of these galaxies in order to reionize the universe. And in the past few years, I've been involved with a number of projects, mainly with the Hubble Space Telescope. And we were looking for examples of galaxies in which we see this process occurring. And one of the conclusions or predictions is that what you need is a very high punch from supernovae in early starburst that punch holes in the interstellar medium, and that those holes allow then your UV photons to escape. Another interesting topic that we've come across are these regions where we have large overdensities of galaxies at very high redshifts of around 6 to 8. And these are the earliest formation stages of galaxy clusters. And we believe that these could be major sources of reionization because they are so large in the sky and they contain a lot of star-forming galaxies. And they're also the first structures to form. And so undoubtedly, they play some role in reionization. We're also interested in the origin of black holes. A couple of years ago, we discovered the first radio galaxy in the epoch of reionization. We already know many quasars at these redshifts, but a radio galaxy is new. This was one of the top discoveries made with the Gemini Observatory in 2018 using our Brazilian time. If you are not so impressed by these images, then I completely agree with you, but luckily we will have HST and JWST data scheduled to be taken next year. Lastly, what I find a fascinating puzzle is the origin of the supermassive black holes. We know that there are quasars at very high redshifts, redshift 6, 7, and 8, that contain black holes that are already as massive as the famous black hole in our local galaxy, M87. And so a big question or puzzle is how did these black holes manage to form so big so quickly? I recently submitted a paper analyzing one of these quasars at redshift 6. This is a radio-allowed quasar. It has also extremely massive black hole. And we analyzed the region around this quasar and found that actually there is a lot of stuff happening around this quasar. So this is the first quasar where we see a lot of galaxies around it. And this could be an indication that actually this type of environment is sort of an ideal environment for creating what's called a direct collapse black hole seed. So it's a black hole that starts out very massive, and then it's quite easy to grow it further into a supermassive black hole compared to, for example, if it had to start from a small black hole from a population tree star. I have two more slides. We don't need to wait 10 years for news in these fields. As I said, next week, we hope to see the launch of the James Webb Space Telescope. We have several programs that we're leading studying these kind of topics that I just mentioned. A few months ago, we managed to get the Journal National to talk about a radio galaxy. I think it was probably the first and the last time that you see a radio galaxy on Journal National. And a few weeks ago, my student Katarina Aydar did a fantastic piece on TV Brasil. The reason why I'm showing you this is because these are examples of this great attractor potential of projects like James Webb and GMT that are actually, this trickles down to society in some way that is really difficult to express in a pure dollar amount. So if you want to find out more, here's various links. I really invite you to look at the GMT science book, or at least download it and put it on your desktop. Or write to me, we'll send you a paper copy. It's a fantastic piece of work highlighting all these science cases. And I'd like to point out the GMT science community meeting. Every year until before the pandemic, we organize a meeting for the whole astronomical community, not just GMT. The last meeting was a face-to-face meeting in 2019. We decided that the next meeting was going to be on black holes from stellar mass to supermassive scales. Rodrigo Nemen, who is also here, is a member of the scientific organizing committee. And we decided actually to postpone this meeting until 2022 now in order to really have a face-to-face meeting and not another Zoom meeting. I put a link here to an interesting, funny video, Construção do GMT, that was made by the GMT Brazil office as sort of an outreach project. And I also like to point out a fantastic series of a documentary series related to GMT and GMT science. It was produced for GMT Brazil office with the help of TV Univap. So thank you very much.
João, você está mudo.
Okay, we have time for one question only, and maybe Miguel was the first to raise his hand.
Miguel, hi. Hi, João. Thanks, Roderick. Nice talk. So I have a question, since I only can have one, on the three telescopes. So the three large ones, the extremely large ones, do they have any major differences among them, let's say, on attendue or on instrumentation and anything that sets them apart from the collecting area and who gets constructed first?
Okay, so I would say the main thing that sets TMT apart from GMT and ELT is that it has access to the Northern Hemisphere. It's actually kind of unfortunate that it looks like that the two projects that are the most advanced are both in Chile. Now, of course, there lots of major telescopes are in Chile, so that's absolutely no problem. But imagine that the Gravitational Wave Observatory, for example, finds very curious events in the Northern Hemisphere. We wouldn't have a way to access that. So that I think that could be a problem. But it's more of a problem of luxury, right? in terms of instrumentation, there are many nuances. I would say that all three telescopes have a suite of instrumentation, from the UV to the near infrared in imaging and spectroscopic modes, multi-object spectroscopy in ways that are similar or complementary. But actually, it's mainly an issue of so there will be differences in terms of how the funding flows. Right, not all these instruments will come online at the same time. Some observatory may be able to have to start with 5 or 6 instruments, whereas others will just have 1 or 2 instruments at the start.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Roderick. So now the next speaker will be Carlos Alexandre Vinch, Alex from INPI. And he's going to talk about 21 centimeter cosmology and the Bingo radio telescope. So Alex, are you ready?
Yes. I will share the screen. I need the authorization to share my screen.
Rogério said you already had the authorization before the session.
It seems not.
Let me see if I can give you. Okay, now you should have.
Okay, let me try. Host disabled participant screen sharing.
Now
I was able to do it when we did the test before the lunch break.
The problem is that he has 2 users. So, João, we have to go to vunche-imp and make that a co-host.
Okay, that's right.
Okay.
Let me get out of the other one.
Alex, you're the host now. The other Alex is the host. Oh, okay.
Okay. Got it. It happens that I was on a much larger screen here, so oh well. I will try to get back there. Hold on a second. Okay, perfect. Well, okay, ready. Well, thanks for the invitation. Thanks, Rogério, for the time put to make this new event work. And my idea here is to give you an upgrade of the current status of Bingo after mentioning what's coming as an exciting field after the 21 centimeter cosmology. My first slide is just a memory of the person who made this thing work and put together physicists and astronomers from more than a decade together. So let's pay the homage to Ofer's work. So the plan of the talk, since I have roughly 25 minutes, is just give an overview of why 21 centimeter cosmology is exciting. And then I'll give you an upgrade of Bingo, which is had a number of good news in the last 3 months. So the main motivation is that although we are in a time of a very large number of surveys and very high quality data, as Roderick just mentioned before, we have a few questions to answer, which are sort of key questions in physics and astrophysics, which are the origin of inflation, nature of dark matter and dark energy. And there's a number of Department of Energy flagship projects devoted to that, you know, satellites and instruments on the ground. And it's probably moving people together from all over Earth. And particularly what we are interested in Bingo is how can we set constraints in dark energy properties using baryonic acoustic oscillations. So if we look at the dark energy observation program, and we can go over observational cosmology setup, we can go to Dave Weinberg's paper from 2013 and check four observational targets that can be used to probe dark energy. We have galaxy cluster counters, supernova 1A, weak lensing, and baryon acoustic oscillations. So they target different observables, and put together, they probably are a very powerful probe of across a wide range of redshifts. So we can constrain the properties of matter clustering before dark energy starts dominating the universe and after it started dominating the universe. And this is some instruments which are key to this job: with James Webb, SKA, the Vera Rubin telescope, the satellite Euclid, and the DESI survey. What I call the attention here is that we can also target baryonic acoustic oscillations in the radio wave band, which has not been done so far, mostly using the 21 centimeter hydrogen emission line data. So what's the relation of the 21 centimeter cosmology and BAOs? We know that there's a standard ruler that's defined by the sound propagation speed during the recombination time. It's very well defined at CMB measurements from WMAP and Planck. And this this value is around 150 megaparsecs. And that can be used as a ruler in angular distance to check the evolution of matter clustering in the universe. Since they come from the CMB time, and it's well known, we can start checking these properties across a different range of redshifts. And what we propose is an alternative to optical BU, because optics has already been very well measured and it's been used as a kind of a cross check when we estimate cosmological parameters with the CMB data. And the option that we offer is to use a radio measurement that's called intensity mapping. And it's sort of complementary to the optical data because it covers a very wide area in the sky much faster than an optical survey. It integrates all the photons that come, all the intensity emission that comes from even known and unknown sources. So we get all the radiation emitted by these sources. And we use this intensity mapping distribution as a mass tracer. So we can, if you measure across redshift space, we can even identify redshift space distortion information. And another thing is that it's complemented to optical survey because it has different systematics. We can check same redshift range, different wavelengths, different systematics, and we probably profit from the combination of different data. There's a caveat here that although there's a large number of photometric surveys coming out due to some strange effects, we will probably profit from this cross correlation much more if we have spectroscopic surveys. Coming back to the radio thing, we use the CNB toolkit for that. All the data analysis and data reduction tools for radio telescopes have been fine-tuned for more than 30 years. And we are adapting this to 21 centimeter data for the last maybe decade. There's a comparison between what we see as a matter power spectrum as a correlation function. We see these are Fourier pairs in space. The power spectrum and the correlation functions, they tell roughly the same information, but in different spaces. And you see a peak, where you see a peak in the correlation function, you should expect wiggles in the power spectrum. So people in the optics look for the baryon peak. And people in the radio, we have the 21 centimeter power spectrum and look for the wiggles that bow superimpose in that power spectrum after we clean up and have that 1 centimeter hydrogen data. This is a quick animation of what we expect from the BAO. If you see a wave propagating after an initial dispersion of the wave front, and if you have this happening in different points of space, if you see that this rings around the center of perturbation, they superimpose, and very soon it will be hard to distinguish the rings by themselves. So statistically, you will look for the distance between the center of perturbation and the rings, and measurements of many pairs of objects in the radial direction, in the surface, in the plane of the sky. Measurements will give you these rings. They are essentially measuring the plane of the sky. And then at the very end, you add up all these counts, and you will see a preferential separation among the galaxies. And this preferential separation is the BAO, BAO scale. That's exactly what this movie shows you. Just let the movie complete. And this ends up with some things to worry about, which is the statistics of the object distribution and the sample, the sky sample that you're having for these calculations. So essentially, that's what you're looking for. If you have a clean 21 centimeter power spectrum, that's what you expect. If you have a BAO superimposed, you see the wiggles on top of that. If you have a non-wiggle theoretical 21 centimeter and you subtract from your data. And if you're lucky, you expect to see this wiggles that is in the box insert down here. But we are talking about something that's very tiny. We are talking about roughly 44 microkelvin, depending on the parameters that we use here. This figure changes a little bit depending on how you calculate it, but it's never larger than 180 microkelvin. So what we do is we are looking for slices in the sky. Then you see the tangential direction. You have the angular distance here and have the angle that you probe in the sky. And if you have the slices, you see the radial information coming from the redshift slices, and that's weighted by the Hubble parameter here. And then HZ and DHZ, they are picture on the left, and you see that they have perpendicular and parallel directions. So the superposition of the rings will give you this, and at the very end, you have to statistically disentangle the rings. And you have to deal with the cosmic variance, because there's a number of Fourier modes you have in your survey depends on the large part of the sky that you're able to measure. And you have the short noise, the number of objects that you probe in there. That's the uncertainty in the power spectrum that you measure. So this is the BAO scale. And why we do that in radio? Because it's complementary to optics, because we have a lot of hydrogen over the universe, 75% of the visible matter is hydrogen. Although it's the hyperfine transition doesn't happen too much, you probe in the full history down to the dark ages, so it's feasible. You can do that with other elements. You can do with carbon and with H-alpha as well. But hydrogen, the neutral hydrogen, is the best bet. And then we have approaches that address interferometers, which is mostly what's being done today, and approaches that address single dishes, which is what BINGO aims to. But this is a very hot topic. You see the number of instruments that are being built or are already working for 21 centimeter measurements. You have even things planted in space like there, and you have Bighorns and in Antarctica and many other instruments all over the world. And people are waiting for, by the end of this decade, for the SKA starting operation. Meanwhile, we have room for a lot of contributions. So what we do is to check here the neutral hydrogen. The reionization removes the neutral hydrogen, just ionizing it again. But even close to the time, the current time, we find neutral hydrogen in some parts of the galaxies. And then we can probe this evolution across time. I'll go quickly over this hyperfine transition line. And what's interesting is that we do the redshifted frequency, and the smaller the frequency, the farther in redshift you are. So the frequency that you select for your radio instrument directly relates to the redshift you've been able to probe. The basic idea is, going back to radiative processes in astrophysics, is to see how the cloud where you have neutral hydrogen works when you're excited by something in the background. That can be the CMB temperature, that can be maybe Lyman alpha or other exciters or other absorbers. But essentially, you solve the radiative transfer equation with different temperatures. Related to the spin temperature, that's TS here. So whenever TS is similar to TCMB or the other temperature that excites the cloud, you don't have a 21 centimeter feature, either absorption or emission. And the physics is all enclosed in this equation, and you have the astrophysics part in the blue and the cosmology part in the red. Here you have the radiation field temperature, the baryon fraction, the spin temperature that deals with the hyperfine transition. And here you have the line of sight gradient of the radial information and the Hubble parameter and the redshift and so on. What I have to say in this very short time is that this temperatures, essentially the spin temperature, is modulated by other temperatures that give you absorption or emission during the times. And this coupling constant, X alpha, XC, they are related to the Einstein coefficients of emission and absorption. And essentially you have collisions and you have heating from Lyman alpha, and you have a coupling that's related to the radiation fields that's called Wolterstein field coupling. And the thing is that we do that to intensity mapping, which, as I said, collect all the radiation for all the source that you have in your field of view instead of looking at individual points. This is a simulation for the carbon monoxide, but we did that for hydrogen in the BINGO work the last 2 years. As I said, you can do that with different instruments and different emissions from different elements. Give you different physics. So different environments and different physics give you a deeper understanding of the star formation process at high redshift. And essentially, you can see beyond reionization time with SKA. So you see the clustering time before the first stars formed. That's the formalism. You have a shot noise caused by the number of objects that you measure, and then you have the metapole spectrum, the bias because of the tracing between the meta distribution and the total meta content. And at the small case, which are large scales, you have the clustering effect. And we have a larger case, small scales, you have the shot noise. So the highlights is that, as I mentioned before, many advantages, some disadvantages, which I have to mention, is complicated to disentangle the foregrounds, Galap and radio source emissions from the intensity mapping signal, because it's much, much stronger than the cosmological signal. You have confusion from interloping emission lines for other elements. You have a non-Gaussian nature, it's more complicated to treat. So we are developing some techniques to deal with non-Gaussianity in the data. And the calibration uncertainties in radio, especially when you have the frequency range that's very close to man-made devices that makes your life hell. So there's some intensity mappings which are working. And then I'll go quickly to Bingo. So these are the partners, the most important here. INPE, University of São Paulo and Federal de Campina Grande, together with Manchester and University College London, and many other people scattered in four continents. Our main sponsors are FAPESC, the Ministério da Ciência e Tecnologia, FAPESC from Paraíba, the Yangtze University in China, and very recently the Governo da Paraíba has sponsored significantly to the Bingo efforts. So we are in a survey area, which is pretty much covered by only one instrument, that's FairX, and partially covered by TNLI, the Chinese one. So in Redshift, we have pretty much no competitors at this point, but across Redshifts, you can have a complementarity of pretty much all the other instruments that you see working in intensity mapping experiments. And we have an angular scale that is not too large. So we cover just 14% of the sky. But we do that in a mode that's the dedicated survey. So we do that 24 hours, seven days a week. So in the area covered, so you see Bingo is not too much. As I said, you have FAST and TNLI covering much more, Chime much more, HyREX much more, SKA much more. But you have the dedicated ones like COMAP here and COMAP, the other detector, covering a much smaller area in the sky in a dedicated patch. So the main size case, as I said, is to measure BAOs, do intensity mapping radio, but additional side can give you matter density distribution, redshift distortions, anisotropic BAOs, life history of hydrogen, Radio combination lines and fast radio bursts, which come for free due to the way we observe the sky. So most of the funding is until yesterday was already granted. We have Elcio Abdallah coordinating it from USP, a management team as a sub-coordination with me at INPE, Luciano Barozzi, Felipe Abdallah, and Bin Wang in different places in the world.
Alex, you have 5 minutes, okay?
Okay, I'm counting here, thanks. So essentially is we needed what we got yesterday. The dish fabrication was sponsored by the Paraíba government state. So it's granted. So we have the dishes and now we can proceed. I think now we can have Bingo working next year. So that's the fiducial phase of phase one that goes for 5 years. The main thing is that the coverage here, 5,000 square degrees. Beam resolution is the very suitable for the BAL measurements, for the BAL scale of 150 megaparsecs. This is the frequency, the sampling time, and the telescope orientation. It's not too large, 63 meters focal length, 50 meters for the main mirror. It's not too large. The primary area is 1,060 square meters. It's a fixed telescope, no moving parts, so you see the same part of the sky every day, which helps tracking transients, which is the second science of Bingo. So the challenge that we have listed here big dishes, so we have to align them when they come from China. Large horns, we assume improving the fabrication process. We have one good prototype, but the mass production needs some improvements. We know how to do the calibration stability, but we have to test it in the lab. It's ongoing now. The digital backend that do the Fourier transform works very well. The prototypes as a road to is working, was already integrated and tested. The optical design was completed, so we were able to purchase the dishes. That's the sky covers that we have. This the sector here, so we superpose with this, with 6DF, with Wiggle Z, with Punstar. There's a lot of to do, but most of them are photometric surveys, so not the best option, but we can deal with it. We superpose with LSST. This is the Bingo pipeline. So I'll quickly close with the latest results that we had. We have a paper on archive. That's the overall mission. This is the table of contents. So describe the cosmology, the astrophysics that we do. We describe the synergy with other instruments. That's the paper one from Bingo. Paper two, the instrument paper, describes all the hardware, calibration setup, the site measurements, and everything related to the putting the optical design into place. This is a picture of the lab this morning. So we have two horns here under testing, polarizer and stuff scattered all over the lab, which I share with Odilio. That's the chamber gravitational antenna here. That's the cooler. So we are sharing this space at INPI. So the optical design tested four different optical designs. We end up with this solution. And this is the simulations of the focal plane with the Stokes parameters. We have a very low side lobe. And we think that with this, we can avoid polarization leakage and do a clean measurement of the 21 centimeter signal. We had a simulation paper that deals with number of horns and how you recover the signal. So we simulate Bingo. We see that horns, between 30 and 50 horns are quite enough for what we do, for the kind of surveys that we have here. So they kind of superimpose in the area that we do. This is the power spectrum of the signal from the galaxy and stuff. And the hydrogen is right here in the middle. So you see synchrotron and brain swelling as the most intense contributions. And this is the recovery of the signal in the data. This is forecasts for dark energy parameters, the W of the equation of state here, and parameters of dark energy. And then you have for different setups. This is a simulation of MOC catalogs, anybody simulation for number of halos that would be able to produce 21 centimeter data. We were able to constrain the 21 centimeter distribution and the hydrogen distribution. And we think that these mocks will be very useful to do the simulation. We have the real Bingo data. And something that's under final revision is a paper that tests the forecasts of detecting BAL. So we do two procedures. We use the correlation function in the power spectrum. And we separate the Bingo beams in two different sectors of redshift. And we see that we are able, in some of these beams, we are able to reproduce even with the presence of noise. We have to refine these estimates later on with when we have a clear measurement of 21 centimeter. But we think we are in a very good shape. So forthcoming papers are fast radio burst data analysis, this led by Marcelo Novaes in Paraíba. Refining of our ground separation map making, which will be able to be with 1/F by Eduardo Medicia. The Bingo receiver led by Fred Vieira. This is something that should be out next year. And we are working, I think, with cross correlations with optical surveys, something that made us get closer to Rogério and Vivian Miranda with LSST. And our schedule, this is my last slide. As of today, if nothing else goes wrong, because many things went wrong during this pandemic times, is to have the final system assembled to start commissioning no later than March 2023. Even if it's just one horn or two horns, we'll be able to start taking data next year, by the end of next year. So thanks, and visit us at bingotelescope.org.
Okay, thank you, Alex. And I think we can go directly to the discussion session. And so we are now open to questions to all the speakers of today's talks. Okay, so